Amen. Good morning. So Pastor Kim and Joy are on vacation this week, so you got me. But we are blessed to have Jane to help play piano for us today. Jane's doing double duty too, because she's going to share with you about a little bit of the trusty work week. So come on up, Jane. Let us know how we're doing.
On behalf of the trustees, I thank everyone who came out to support our work week. Throughout the week, we had several people come in to take care of some of the tasks around the building. Yesterday, we had a great turnout. All kinds of people came out, rolled up their sleeves, and jumped right in to get a lot of jobs done around here. Excuse me. So thank you to all of you who did that. The best part about it was seeing everybody come together. People from all three services had a chance to work together, get to know each other a little bit better. I was able to put names to faces of people that I see passing every Sunday but haven't taken the time to get to know. And that was a real treat for me. I just want to leave you with this one thought. We have a great church filled with great people, and I am greatly blessed to be part of it. So thank you very much.
Yeah, so just right before this service, as I was eating a whoopie pie, and yes, they are still delicious a week later, someone dropped a whoopie pie on the floor. I said, we just cleaned this carpet. No, I didn't say that. I said, this carpet's so clean, you could eat right off it. And that's what they did. They bent down and finished the, no. Okay, but I've got some good news today, friends, as well, on behalf of Staff Parish. Do you like good news? Good. Yes, we like good news. So I am privileged to be able to announce on behalf of Staff Parish is that we have a new administrative assistant starting at Trinity here on Tuesday, and that person is Deb Rollins. Thank you, Deb. That was the loudest of all three services. 11 o'clock is the favorite service now. Yes. So I just want to say that Pastor Kim and I generally, you know, we make this look good because we look good. But really, if you want to know who runs this place, it's Deb. So if you've got any questions, thanks, Deb. Seriously, our volunteers, our staff are fantastic. We are so excited for Deb to be part of our staff team here at Trinity. So welcome her this week, and if you've got any questions, please reach out to her. I just wanted to share with you a couple things happening in the life of our church. You see your bulletins. I know you might be thinking to yourself, you know, Pastor Michael, after we've seen you play handbells, it can't get any better than that, can it? It can't. It can't. Well, I would invite you next Sunday, April 21st at 4:30. Philadelphia Bronze will be here as part of our Shirley Hazelton concert series. And yeah, I think they're better than me. The fantastic musicianship. It's going to be a great time of music. So come, bring a friend, 4:30 next Sunday here in the sanctuary. This Saturday, we have our special Someone Dance. If you would like to come and have a great time, let us know this week so we can prepare enough food and places to sit and things like that. All sorts of wonderful opportunities happening in the life of our church. So I wanted to open us with a word of prayer, and let's gather our hearts together for worship. Gracious God, we come to you today and we thank you for your mercy that is new for us today, a mercy that invites us to experience the newness of your love. We pray that you would speak to our hearts today as we worship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let me invite you, if you're able, to please stand as Synergy will lead us in a time of worship.
Good morning.
Morning.
Let me try that again. I think the microphone was off. Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay. And we've got that beautiful sun out there, and it's just going to make, you know, us feel much, much better about our coming week. So join us as we sing, I will worship. Okay.
Thank you.
worship.
I will worship
with all of my heart.
All of my heart.
I will praise you.
I will praise you
with all of my strength.
All my strength.
I will seek you.
I will seek you
for all of my days.
All of my days.
I will follow. In the dark and all alone, growing comfortable, are you too scared to move and walk out of this tomb? Buried underneath the lies that you believed, safe and sound, stuck in the ground, too lost to be found.
You're just asleep. And it's time to leave. Come on, arise up. Take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? Your brand new power of death couldn't hold you. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus?
Rise up. Was more than blood, it's the kind of love that washes sin away. Now the door is open wide, then the stone's been rolled aside. The old is gone, and the light has come. So come on and rise up,
take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? Your breath.
Take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice?
Hear the good news. Nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. So as God's forgiven people in his name, let's greet one another with the very peace and love of Christ. Before you're seated, greet one another with love. May the peace of Christ be with you. Good morning and welcome. On your way in, you may have received a Connect card, and so if you have any prayer requests, you can jot those down and place those in the offering plate later in our time of worship, and we have a prayer team that is praying for those prayer requests every day. And also, maybe if you're visiting with us for the first time, if instead of placing that Connect card in the offering plate, if you greet one of our ushers or greeters or me after the service, hand me that Connect card. We have a handy dandy special gift for you today. We'd love to share this with you. And it's filled with cash and a picture of me. Is that what? No, other good stuff. I mean, I can't think of anything better than a picture of me. But also, thank you to our hospitality and welcome team. They've got all sorts of goodies in there for those that are worshiping with us for the first time. I wanted to today have a time of sharing before we go to the Lord in a time of prayer. A chance for us to share some joys and concerns. We're actually going to sing a hymn, and then I'll lead us in a time of congregational prayer. Are you willing to do that today? Is that all right? Okay, so let's start with some joys. All right, I'm going to get us started. It's a joy to see you today, Dave, all the way there in the back, my friend. Dave, it's good to see you, my friend. How you feeling? Hanging in. Yeah. We've had a rough road the past couple months, but looks like you're doing okay, all right? Yes, you have a wonderful caregiver. It's so good to see you. It's good to see you. Last time I saw you, you were in the hospital. Yeah? That's good to see you here in church. So that's a joy. What are some other things we're celebrating today? Tony?
So my parents are moving to Woodbury Mews.
Okay. All right.
And they're going to become part of our church. And Karen, my dad, is a singer. He'd love to be in the choir.
All right. Good. So I'm going to repeat for the people on the live stream because they can't hear you without a microphone. So I'm just going to say that Tony's parents are moving to Woodbury from North Jersey. We're excited to have them be closer to family and closer to us as a congregation, that they're going to bless us, and we hope to bless them as well. Great. Good news. Yes, Irene. All right, so a grandson returning from military service after 6 months. So yes, we're praying for his safe return. And of course, that is a constant prayer request as well for the men and women serving in our armed forces, foreign and domestic, of course. We've got some members of our church that are serving overseas right now, but it's good when they come home too. Yeah. Any other joys? Anything else you're celebrating today? The beauty of God's creation. Yeah, it's a beautiful day. It's good to give thanks. Right. Yes, Sue? Amen. So Sue was sharing that she had an oblation this week, and they discovered that she does have a heart, and it's big heart. We all know that already. We know that already, Sue. You've got a lot of love in your life, but you came through that procedure well. It's good to see you, and continue to pray for your health and the doctors as they come up with some news and care for you, okay? Yeah, good thing you came through that. Good, good. Any prayer requests today? I know we, you know, have the Connect card and things like that and our prayer list as well. I do know that I found out last night Mary and Gaffney's in the hospital, so we're praying for her. What are some other things that you'd like to let us know as a community we can be praying about today? Yes. So prayers for Janice Gansert, who was diagnosed with Bell's palsy, and for your cousin, what's their first name? Nancy. Okay, Nancy, who was diagnosed with cancer. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay, prayers for Kevin going through chemo, yeah. All right, prayers for Kevin. Yes. Okay, prayers for Doris with, you said oral cancer. Okay. Doris, yes.
Someone who grew up here as a child, Joan Wilson's sister.
Yeah.
Joan.
Joan. Oh. Okay. So Joan passed away, Bill Wilson's sister. But what was, I guess her name was Joan Wilson, growing up as a kid here. Her married name is Joan Haddock, passed away. So prayers for the Wilson family, the Haddock family, at their loss. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yes?
My dad is in the hospital with heart failure.
Okay. Remind me of his first name.
Ellis.
Ellis? Prayers for Ellis, who's in the hospital with heart failure. Okay, as we prepare to go to the Lord in a time of prayer, I'd like to sing, it's a beautiful hymn by Charles Wesley. It's called Depth of Mercy. It's number 355. Let's sing this, and then I'll lead us in a time of prayer. Depth of mercy. Mercy still reserved for me. Can my God his wrath forbear? Me, the chief of sinners, spare. I have long withstood his grace, long provoked him to his face. Mercy on us, O Lord. Today we come before you in hope and faith and trust. We can do so with confidence because your word reminds us of who you are as one who is holy, one who is love.
one who is gracious, compassionate, abounding in mercy, slow to anger. You are good. And we know that when we come to you and we cast our cares to you, you care for us, that you are concerned with that which concerns us. Hear our prayers today, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. As we've shared celebrations, we thank you for the joy. We thank you for the moments where we get to see goodness and praise, where we acknowledge that you have carried and brought us through. But yet this is our hope and the goodness of your promise that you are always with us, not just in the moments of celebration, but also in the moments of hurt, of weakness, of pain. We've named those before you and one another, but we also pray, Lord, have mercy for that which is on our hearts unsaid. Hear our prayers. We ask that you would give strength to the weak, allow for your presence to comfort and to help. Surround those in need. Thank you for those you have provided to care for us, the doctors and the nurses, the friends and the family members that love us and help us in our time of need. And we humbly pray today, Lord, that you would, by our example and witness, allow for us to be your people who might be able to be the answer to someone else's prayer, that we might be a friend to those who are lonely, that we might speak a word of faith to those who are doubting, that we might be able to carry one another as we carry one another in our prayers and thoughts. We've named also not just our friends and family, but also the need around our world of war and pain. We ask for your peace. We are humbled by the goodness of your mercy today. And we, as your people, offer our praise and glory unto you alone, O God. Hear our prayers. Help us to remember that we are indeed your beloved children as we unite our hearts and our voices together as one, by praying the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let me invite for Nancy Stetson to come at this time. She's going to share with us from the Gospel of Matthew in the 9th chapter. Over the next couple weeks, we're going to be looking at the stories of where Jesus heals the blind. So this one's from Matthew chapter 9.
Good morning, everybody. So yes, I'll be reading Matthew chapter 9, verses 27 through 31. As Jesus went out from there, two blind men followed him, calling out, "Have mercy on us, son of David." And when he had gone indoors, the blind men came to him, and he asked them, "Do you believe that I am able to do this?" "Yes, Lord," they replied. Then he touched their eyes and said, "According to your faith, let it be done to you." And their sight was restored. And Jesus warned them sternly, "See that no one knows about this." But they went out and spread the news about him all over the region. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
It's about that time of year, isn't it, friends, where students have to finalize what they're going to put in their yearbook to forever memorialize what they want to leave with the world. Their quote, their statement, their hopes, where they want to be after graduation. Better make sure it's all, you know, spell checked and everything, because they got to publish these yearbooks. Do you remember doing that? Remember what you wrote? I was trying to find my yearbook. I don't think I saved my yearbooks, because when you look at me in high school, let's just say that the 90s were my awkward period, the whole decade of them. I wasn't always the handsome that you see before you today, you know what I'm saying? But my wife, she has all the yearbooks. She loves her yearbooks. She keeps them all. But we love going back and looking at the memories and looking at what people hope for and write about. And, you know, how would you feel if you came across a senior that wrote down, my hopes for the future is that by the time I turn 40, I want to become so disgruntled with my job that I hate my boss, and because I've had my heart broken several times, I refuse to open my heart up to love in the future. You'd be a little concerned, wouldn't you? You see, none of us want to end up at a place of cynicism. The challenge is that while we might begin a journey with hope and optimism, along the way, there's going to be opportunities and hurt that would lead us to consider life and even our faith from a particular situation or circumstance, and that is as a cynic. In fact, Solomon, in all of his wisdom, you can look at the book of Ecclesiastes in the Hebrew Scriptures. In the first chapter, in the 18th verse, says, the more wisdom I gain, the more sorrow I have. We would think, no, if you gain more wisdom, everything's going to be good. He says, the more time I live, the more grief I share. That's why when we kind of or at a certain maybe age, we can look back at maybe how we used to feel and look at where we are now, and we may not be in those same places that maybe we've taken the road of cynicism. When I was called into the ministry in college, I knew I wanted to go straight to seminary. I didn't want to change my major because it would mean a couple more years of college, and I was ready to get out of that town. So I went straight to seminary, which means, so I graduated college, went straight to graduate school, so that I was serving churches when I was in my mid-20s, right? And every month, they would have what they call district days, which is all the clergy would get together at one of the churches, they'd have coffee and they'd have donuts, because if there's anything that clergy need, it's more donuts in our life. We need that like a moose needs a hat rack. And we'd get together, and I tell you, I was the only person in my there represented among clergy in their 20s, or in their 30s, and most likely in their 40s. Now, I loved hearing from the wisdom of those that had, you know, spent a couple more years of life than me and served churches, and I loved sitting down with clergy that were older than me, great mentors of mine. But I noticed over the months that the coffee and the donut time, you know, started to turn into complaint sessions, you know, about what's wrong with this and what's wrong with that. And, you know, because even pastors have bosses, you know what I mean? And yeah, we complain about our boss, you know what I mean? And we talk about this and we talk about that. But I remember as a young and idealistic and optimistic clergy person getting started, I thought to myself, I don't want to ever end up there. Why are they acting that way? Who wants to live like that? Fast forward into the future. Hi. There's times when I'm cynical. Are there times when you, because you've lived a little bit of life, that's what Solomon's getting at, because we have the knowledge, it leads sometimes to sorrow. What does that mean? It means because we've been through some things that we could probably just describe as life. Solomon in Ecclesiastes says, because we know some things and because we've been through some things, sometimes it leads us to sorrow and to grief. How many of us, when we look back at how we felt and the experiences that we shared, while we might have gone into something with an open heart, after our hearts were broken, how much more willing are we to open it again? What's the saying? You fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. Fool me three times, we don't get to the third time ever, do we? Because if I've been fooled twice, most of us would probably say, you ain't getting me again. But that's not a way to live. You see, it's easy to close off, to have a calloused heart. How many of you, when you think about a coworker, might just think that, well, because I've experienced other coworkers in the past that acted a certain way, this new coworker is probably in it for themselves because the other person I worked with was in it for themselves and well as well. And if they were in it for themselves and I start to behave like I'm in it for myself, or a family member or a friend, that you needed help and maybe they weren't there. And we're not as willing then to say, hey, I need help into the future, because we've experienced the wisdom and the knowledge of our past. The challenge with cynicism too is we take that knowledge of our past and we project it into our future. We believe that our future can only be like we experienced it in the past. There has to be another way. The good news is, there's good news. You see, that's what I love the word for when we say the word gospel. It means good news. And I know sometimes we can, when we look at the Bible or we think about our faith life, we always don't think of it as good news. We can see a lot of stories in Scripture where the end doesn't seem to be good news, where we see violence or we see tragedy or we see families that are doing, you know, things that break them apart. But the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ, is that when God comes to us, God takes all of those things that would cause for us to be cynical, the darkness, the despair, the loneliness, the hurt, our past, and our shame. And God just doesn't speak it away. God faces it head on with love. This is what we have been talking about the past couple of weeks when we talk about Jesus' Passion Week, about him facing the brutality of our humanity head on. So when we talk now as an Easter people, when we talk about the empty tomb, about resurrection, this thing called hope is the first thing that cynicism wants to destroy in us. Because if cynicism can take our hope, it can keep us in the past. But the empty tomb, the good news, not just of Jesus' suffering and death, but his resurrection and life, is that we can be a people who can face an unknown future with hope still. Now, just think about all that the disciples would have been feeling on that Friday, on the silence of that Saturday, even on that Sunday morning of Easter. They weren't quite sure. They didn't know what to expect. We see them not quite understanding. Even in the post-resurrection appearances, we've seen the disciples figuring it out along the way. And Jesus comes to us and meets all of that which would cause for us to despair. He meets it with hope because of his presence and because of his love. Now, what we see from the two men in our scripture today is the path out of cynicism, the path towards a hopeful future. These two blind men heard that Jesus was coming along, and they cry out, "Son of David, have mercy on us." You see, I think there's something, that voice within us, that whenever, even in our relationship with God, where we want to name our need, when we want to express to God, whether it's our prayers, have we lived enough or experienced the past or our past knowledge to where maybe we felt like our prayers haven't been answered, or that God didn't help us in that time, And because we felt like God didn't help us in that time, or we see this person that we love going through a tough time, or we had to lose this person, or that which we grieve because of our past, it keeps us quiet. It's easier for us to stay silent and not name our need, because if we name our need, it's just another opportunity for a potential disappointment. But these blind men show us another way. You have to imagine, probably, that, again, they're not children. It says that they were adults. They were men. So they had lived some life. They had experienced some time and some things. Based upon probably the culture of the first century at that time, there weren't a lot of options for them vocationally. They would maybe be dependent upon family or friends to get them to where they needed to go or to help them. Maybe often, like we see throughout Scripture, they were, along the side of the road that would ask for charity. How many times did they ask and didn't receive what they would hope to get? Or they were given something that nobody would want. They might have been called a name or given a word, a disparagement, or unkindness. Now, imagine that they've heard about this guy, Jesus of Nazareth, that's coming along the way. Now, we see throughout the gospel stories that Jesus was starting to become well-known. We see different crowds starting to gather because he was feeding the multitudes. Or we see the stories of how the crowds would gather because they had heard that he was able to help people in their need. He was able to heal those who were sick. Or they heard that he was teaching, unlike the teachers of their day, that he had an authority that he was preaching from. That was unlike anything else that people had heard. In fact, the religious leader says, by whose authority are you saying these things? Even the religious leaders, the crowds, the disciples, everyone that we see Jesus interact with in the Gospels is starting to get familiar when Jesus is going from town to town. Jesus would say, who do people say that I am? They're trying to figure out who he was, but they knew that something was going on with Jesus of Nazareth. Now, imagine that these two blind men hear that he is coming along the way. Maybe they had heard the stories of how he had healed others, helped others with their need. If we're honest with ourselves, if we were those men, would we have remained silent? How many times do we remain silent still today? When the God who loves us, who invites us to be known and to know God, where we have access, how many times are we silent and we don't name our need? Because we listen to the voice of our inner cynic, don't we? Even in our prayer life, even in our spiritual life, even though while we sing of the promises and the faithfulness of God, we struggle to see a hopeful future. Because we've projected our past pain there. So why pray? Why ask? Why? Here he comes. What these men teach us is that they probably would have had every reason in the world to remain silent, yet they cry out nonetheless. Son of David, have mercy on us. What are the things that you feel like you need to cry out to God? That you just need to say, Jesus, have mercy, but you've been too afraid to say it, even in your prayers, because our cynicism still is in control. How do we get out of this? Well, here's the good news. Whenever we feel like I am that cynic, I'm not seeing, a hopeful future. Look, cynics will never change the world because they're too busy telling us how the world will never change. Cynics will never change the world because they're too busy telling us how the world will never change. When we can't get out of projecting our past to our future, we will never see hope. But if we remember
that there is a God of hope who invites us into a hopeful future, then maybe we'll be able to get out of this mindset, silence the voice of our cynic, and cry out for mercy to a God who desires to meet our need. So, I mean, that's kind of like out there esoteric kind of ideas. What's a practical way to do this, friends? Is let's get curious. Let's be curious. Curiosity is the antidote to cynicism. Right? Do you ever read someone that's, you know, cynical and that the world is this and it's never going to change and everybody's this and everybody's that? They're not very curious, are they? Did you meet someone who is curious, regardless of their age? It's not an age thing, right? That they know how to ask questions, they know how to wonder, they know how to listen. See, most of our dialogue in our world now is that we're not listening to each other. We're just coming up with a response while the other person's talking because we think we already know what they're going to say. We stopped listening to each other. We cannot be in dialogue with one another. So therefore, we cannot really see the hope of how things can be different or things can change. We've lost our wonder. We've lost our curiosity because it's easier to stay cynical, believing that we know everything, that the world is this way and it will never change. The empty tomb messes with all of that. Easter breaks down all of that stuff. And it invites us to consider, how can our world be different? What are the questions we need to ask one another? How can we listen to each other well? How do we dialogue with one another? But also, how can we be curious about the wonder and the mystery of God again? That's what will stir our faith, not believing and thinking that we have all of the answers, but believing and thinking and hoping that maybe God has something more for us into our hope-filled future. I know that we've got some stuff in our past, but we don't need to project it. The cross, the empty tomb, helps us see the hope. So maybe we need to ask questions. Maybe we need to be curious. This is what Jesus does, by the way, with these two men. He asks them a question, which questions are always going to be invitations for consideration, for wonder. We're going to see this over the next couple weeks. When Jesus heals the blind, he does it in different ways. Well, today, he asks a question. Do you believe that I am able to do this? And he goes on to say, you know, after he heals them, that their, you know, their faith has made them, that he, you know, the faith has healed them. And so many times I've always heard the idea of the reason we don't see miracles in our world today is because we don't have enough faith. Or the reason this thing didn't happen in your life is because you didn't have enough faith. And for me, that's bogus. That's nonsense. Sometimes I hear people talk about faith as in like a certain numerical thing, like God is waiting for us to hit a certain amount of prayers towards a certain thing, or that God was wishing that we had just a little bit more faith than what we have right now. Oh, I would have done this for you, my beloved child, but you know, you didn't quite hit the mark. This story isn't about that. I know sometimes it can come across that way, to where we see someone who's blind and they say, I need some help. And he says, well, your faith has healed you and all you need to do is have a little bit more faith and nothing bad's ever gonna happen to you. That's not the way our faith life works. This question about whether or not we believe he's able to do it is an invitation, a curiosity of wonder, of faith that says, you can believe, you can trust, you can have faith. This question about whether or not we believe he can do this is an invitation for each one of us today that when we've shut off our belief and we've shut off our trust and we've shut off our hope because of what happened back then, Jesus stands before us now and says, do you believe that I'm able? It isn't going to be a formula that you have to put 1, 2, and 3 together in order to work. It's about an invitation for curiosity. And curiosity is the antidote to cynicism. It says, hey, can you believe again? Can you trust again? Can you hope again?
And I know that there's all sorts of people, you've had all sorts of experiences, and all sorts of time back then that have taught you that it's not good to believe, and it's not safe to trust, and that certain people you can't hope in. And maybe even in our relationships with God. But the empty tomb is an invitation to wonder and be curious that maybe despite all of the things that would cause for me to be despairing, that maybe I can hope, that maybe I can believe again, and maybe I can trust again. Do you believe that he's able to do this? We can probably put together what the this is for the blind men, but I can't name what your this is any more than you're able to name what my this is. But do you believe that he's able to do this? As we close in a word of prayer, maybe this is our time to, in our heart of hearts, say, Son of David, have mercy on me. And probably even while we pray, you might be thinking to yourself, you might hear that voice that says, what's the point? Why pray? Why ask? That's the cynic. Let's start to get curious about what God has for us tomorrow. Because we want to see. We don't want to see back. We want to see into the hopeful future that God has for us. Son of David, have mercy on us. Let us pray. Lord, hear our prayers today. Lord, have mercy. There's been so much that would invite us to remain silent because it's hard to believe and it's hard to trust, but we want to have hope. We want to see what you see. In all the ways where we can't see, open our eyes. In all the ways we've become discouraged, encourage us by your love and invite us to wonder, to be curious, to ask questions, that even when we pray, we believe that you're able to do it. Lord, hear our prayers. Have mercy on us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let me invite for our ushers to come at this time. Part of our worship life is to respond to God's goodness and grace as we share in a tithe and offering. Let us worship in this way. Give in faith, in trust, in belief in your provision in our lives, but also for the sake of others, for your kingdom, that others may come to know of your love. This is our discipleship, our witness, our generosity, and our hope. Bless these gifts and those who give them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let me invite you to remain standing, if able, and we'll sing our closing hymn two times. Number 349, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. Let us pray. Oh God, we desire a faith that sees, a faith that helps us to see that there is a hopeful future for us. Indeed, your purpose, your plan is good, your will is pleasing and perfect. It's good for us. Lord, help us to see the way, to walk in it. That indeed, as your children, we might see what you have for us. Open our eyes. Lord, have mercy. Children of God, go with grace and peace. Remember that you are not sent here for yourselves, but you are sent for others, and our world waits for you. Amen.